Hi and welcome to LawWiser. We all hear about joint ventures a lot these days, but there are a lot of crucial aspects which matter to it and can also lead to its downturn. So to explain to us all the intricacies revolving around joint venture, we have with us expert Mr. Abhijit Mukhopadhyay, President Legal and General Counsel based in Global Headquarters of Hinduja Group. Welcome on board, sir. Thank you for taking time out for us. As we all know, joint ventures are very crucial to any businesses. But at the same time, sir, there are certain aspects to it where if one doesn't pay attention to, a lot can lead to its struggle and downturn. So if you could, you know, explain to us the importance of a clearly defined joint venture agreement.
Joint venture, as I say, is like a marriage. In marriage, you have got two partners. In joint venture, there can be more partners, but at least there will be two partners in any joint venture to start with. The only difference between the marriage and joint venture is that in marriage, we don't sign any agreement what to do, what not to do. Whereas in a joint venture, it is the other way around. It is always not only desirable, but essential to have a properly executed, enforceable joint venture agreement. If you look back and try to analyze why in a joint venture the partners face difficulties, many times it will be found that there is no properly defined, executed, enforceable joint venture agreement with clarity. If there is clarity, then whenever the issues are arising in a joint venture agreement, it is possible you look through the joint venture agreement, try to see what the partners decided before they entered into the agreement, and then act accordingly. I can give you many examples where the disputes became extremely contentious, malicious, and ferocious because the joint venture agreement was not drafted properly. And I can give you one quick example. I have no hesitation in naming the company. It is a dispute between Maruti Udyog Limited and the Government of India and Suzuki Motor Corporation. I was at that time in Maruti Udyog as their chief general manager in charge of legal matters and company secretary. So therefore, I have seen in my own eyes that how a dispute could become such a ferocious, contentious one because there was no clarity in the joint venture agreement. The joint venture agreement was drafted in a very hurried way without understanding what could be the consequences if the clauses were not properly drafted. So that's a classic example. And this example, I give it to everybody, where I always say that it is better you address all the issues at the beginning when you are discussing with your partner, rather than fighting a very expensive, contentious, and time-oriented legal battle, which happened in the case of Maruti Udyog.
This really helps in understanding, you know, sir, how important a joint venture agreement is and how important it is to be clearly defined. But I think another crucial aspect of it is when it comes to minority protection provisions. So if you could throw some light on the clarity on minority protection provisions as well.
I will go back, Sania, what I said in my previous topic. The importance of having a very clearly defined joint venture agreement. Now, you have got different varieties of joint venture partner. I can think of, in fact, many varieties. There could be a situation where you have got 51-49% joint venture, one partner 51, another partner 49. So you can term them as minority, whoever is holding 49%. Then you can have 74-26 scenario, where 74 is the majority and 26% holder is the minority. There could be a situation where there can be 50-50 partnership, that is, there is no minority, but both the shareholders are holding 50%. And then even there could be a situation where you can have 50% plus one share as majority and 50% minus one share as minority. So you have got different varieties of minority shareholders. Now, to what extent their rights will be protected will depend upon, to be very honest with you, how much power or percentage they are holding. Whoever is holding 49% as minority, definitely their power will be much more, their demand will be much more than whoever is holding 26% as minority. So therefore, whoever is the minority, whether it is 51-49 scenario or 74-26 scenario, or even in 50-50 scenario, always there will be a clamor for minority protection rights. And these rights are quite a lot. For example, if I am the minority shareholder, then I can ask for several rights. And let me give you one example. Today in London, our group is building up a $1.5 billion hotel. Now it's a huge hotel. We have got a Spanish partner. We are holding 51% and the Spanish partner is holding 49%. They are also a very, very powerful group, one of the largest companies in Spain. So I have to negotiate very hard with them what kind of minority protection rights could be given to them. And finally, we agreed that they will have representation on many underlying companies which are part of this project, located not only in England, but in different countries around the world for tax efficiency reason. So they have got boardroom position there. But then certainly that is one of the facilities that can be given. Many a times they ask for what is called reserve matters, that I am a minority shareholder, I may be holding 49%, but if you want to take a list of decisions, then you cannot take those decisions unless and until you take my consent or approval. Now, this is a matter, Sunny, of negotiations. If you are a good negotiator, you will try to have a very limited reserve matter list. If you cannot, because you are dealing with a very strong joint venture partner, you have to have quite a big expanded list. And if you can manage, like I was able to manage, they started with a reserve matter list, but eventually I made them agree that they will not have any reserve matter list. So for all these items, I did not have to go to them and take their approval, but they will have proper representation on the board, because at the end of the day, as I said, what I have told at the beginning, joint venture is like a marriage. You can't have confusion, trying to cheat, no transparency, yet you remain as joint venture partner. It is not possible. They are your partners. You have to treat them accordingly. So minority protection is necessary. But whenever I am dealing with joint ventures, I have dealt with many in my life in different organizations. I always say that be transparent, be communicative, be clear what you want. But legally, it would be better if there is a complete understanding between the majority holder and the minority holder, what rights both the partners have decided to give to the minority protection.
Actually, it helps a lot, because sometimes I think these issues later on land up being part of the deadlock resolution and, you know, then eventually the exit mechanism. So if you could just throw some light on, you know, clarity in the deadlock resolution and the exit mechanism as well.
That's a very interesting question, and I am always getting these kind of questions whenever I speak around the world. This is very unfortunate if the joint venture partners starts fighting and then you look through whatever agreements you have executed. And as I have said at the beginning of my discussions, that's why at that point of time, people will look into what kind of clauses have been drafted. It is very unfortunate because when the joint venture partners, they start disputes, then not only the business suffers, even at the end of the day, by even winning the dispute, you may be losing a very valuable joint venture partner. You may be losing a very valuable customer. So I always say, in a joint venture dispute, there is no winner. Both the sides are the loser. So therefore, it is very important that once the dispute starts, it is escalated and you are very clear that what is the mechanism available to really solve the dispute. Now, many mechanisms are available. Normally, the pattern, what we do, we always try to say that let it be localized, let it be sorted out at the local level between the dealing officers. If that is not possible, then you escalate it at different levels. So the bottom line, I always say that in any dispute resolution mechanism, I always say the starting point will be you try to resolve it through dialogue. And there you develop different kind of layers where at different layers the dispute can be addressed. And if it cannot be addressed at different layers, finally let it go at the level of the CEO. I remember when I was the general counsel and company secretary of Indian Aluminium Indal, a major dispute mechanism we were discussing with a Norwegian firm. And after a lot of discussions, we came to the conclusion it is better at the two CEOs level, a small committee is formed. If there is a dispute between you and me and we cannot resolve, it should not harm the project, which was a multi-billion dollar project. Let it ultimately go at the level of the CEO, where they can discuss the dispute in a very objective way. Since they are the CEO, they are empowered to solve a dispute, to take decisions. They will decide in the best interest of the project, which people down below the line may not be able to see. And it worked out. So that is one way. In our hotel project I was referring to, there is a dispute resolution mechanism at the top where the two shareholders can meet and then arrive at some kind of conclusion. So bottom line, I want to say that always try to have different dispute resolution mechanism, and that should be properly reflected, drafted with full clarity in the joint venture agreement. Even when we are drafting the dispute resolution clause and putting it in the agreement, we always take the shortcut, find out and then do some cut and paste kind of business. My experience shows that if you don't have a proper dispute resolution clause, arbitration clause, then you are in for trouble. Even in the arbitration clause, standard clause you rely upon, make it very clear. Say which rules of arbitration, how many arbitrators, venue, the proceedings will be conducted in which language. Most of the time, we don't have the time to do it. So we do some kind of cut and paste. And I have seen eventually that clause itself is contested and then we'll be spending money. Now, if you don't want contentious fight, then it is better when I cannot really agree with what you are telling as joint venture partner, then I should be given an opportunity to exit. So the point that I'm trying to make is that very clear exit mechanism should be available in the joint venture agreement. And that mechanism could be right of first refusal. When there is a dispute and the dispute is not resolved after exhausting all the processes which are properly laid out in the joint venture agreement, it is better that people separate it out. And then while separating it out, instead of selling my own stake to a third party, first I will offer it to you as the joint venture partner. And there is a proper mechanism available, put everything in the joint venture agreement, This is what we call right of first refusal. If both of us agree to exercise that right, price, etc., is sorted out, then you pick up my shareholding and you carry on and you do whatever you want with my holding. The other mechanism that could be thought of is that you, with the proper consultation with the joint venture partner, bring a third party and see that the third party becomes the owner. But it should not be through the back door. That should be a mechanism available that if I want to sell my minority holdings or my majority holdings or whatever, then I will not offer it to you because you are also telling I don't need your share. But I can bring a third party with proper consultation and proper agreement with both the parties, and then it can be sold to them. There is another angle which you may have to see, which normally should not happen. That is liquidation of the joint venture company. Now, if there is a fight between the two partners, and if there is provision in the agreement, then in such an event, if the fight is unresolved, then it is better that I liquidate the company. But this is quite impractical. Say, for example, whenever I am executing a huge project, certainly I cannot liquidate the company and then go home, because what will then happen to the project?
Thank you, sir. It is a pleasure having you on board. Thanks a lot. Thank you for taking time out, because to be able to understand a very complicated topic like this and in a very simple way with all the examples, real life practical examples that you've given us. Thanks a lot, sir.